6 years ago, when my friends from the army and the industry heard about the decision to establish the Israel National Cyber Directorate, we were very cynical about it. For us, cybersecurity was defense agencies, just as this day the army protects against kinetic attacks. But the growing volume of cyber attacks that we are facing since then showed that civilian cyber threats are a huge challenge for our national defense, economic well-being, and our citizens' privacy. And that is our role to protect our civilian. Looking globally, right now, there are 2.8 trillion connected devices. In 2018, 5 billion personnel data have been lost, and $6 trillion losses to cybercrime. The Israel National Cyber Directorate provides services and guidance for all civilians entities as well as for critical infrastructure. We provide the services with the intent that each person in Israel has the right to use technology without fear. But we all know that we cannot secure everything. We are constantly looking for ways to reduce cyber risk for our citizens. At this point, I would like to call to the stage and present our distinguished guest for the panel. Mrs. Maria Thompson, State Chief Risk Officer from North Carolina State, United States of America. Brigadier General Professor Jacob Nagel, Faculty of Aerospace Engineering, Technion Haifa, former NSA to Prime Minister and FON head of NSC Israel. Mr. Wani, Vice President, Information Security Industry Group in Korea, Internet and Security Agency, KISA, South Korea. I would like to open the discussion by hearing your perspective about the government's cyber obligation to its citizens. Let's start with you, Maria.
Great. Good morning, everyone. Thank you for this opportunity to present to you today. This is truly an honor. As you've heard, I'm with the state of North Carolina. So just to give you a little bit of background, we have roughly 100 counties in the state of North Carolina, which is comprised of 532 municipalities, so we're talking about cities, towns, et cetera. We have our challenges just like all of you, and when it comes to cyber, that is just even more exponential. What we are doing within North Carolina is a huge outreach, and I know it's similar to you. A lot of you are probably engaged in the same actions. How can we better educate our constituents within North Carolina? How can we facilitate information sharing, because we see that as one of our huge gaps that we have as it pertains to getting that information out, making sure that we can build our cybersecurity posture within these states and within these counties. If you can imagine, as you go further down, and I'm prior military, by the way, so I may go into my military mode, but as you leave the command structure and you get away from big government and you go further into local government, you'll see that you have lack of resources, funding, so on and so forth. So as you go down the stack, you have more risks that you have to deal with. So we understand that, and we're doing our very best to make sure that we protect our citizens, especially when we think about our critical infrastructure that lies within these local counties. How can we ensure that these businesses, whether they're private or public, are taking the right precautions to make sure that they are protected, that they follow a standard framework, that they're constantly monitoring their systems, remediating their systems, and that when something does go bump in the night, that they will alert us so that we can take that information and proliferate it across the environment and make sure that somebody else who could potentially be susceptible to it protects themselves as well. So it's a huge undertaking for us, but you know, I like to consider it a winning hearts and minds campaign that we're doing within the state of North Carolina, and you know, I'm looking forward to all the future successes that we have in that.
Thank you. Professor Nagel.
Okay, good morning. First of all, I want to open and to say that governments should be involved in the cybersecurity strategy. It was also a question. I was part of Professor Ben Israel 7 years ago. We called it then the Kubernetes initiative that the security directorate, just my good friend Igal Luna presented, came from. And it was then a question, what is the government role? I want to raise up some questions more than answers. Maybe we'll have time to talk about some of the answers later. Even so, this is a cyber security conference. I want to make sure that everyone understands that the cyber is only one ingredient in the equation. Sometimes it brings up a mixing between the civilian and the military dimensions. It's not regular that you see that most of the people that are working in cybersecurity are paramilitary or people that came from the defense establishment. Now, the awareness to the damage scale or the damage possibility, it's very, very different between the civilians. Yet, it's too small and it's too high sometimes at the government officials. It's only, again, cyber, it's one more dimension. We have to keep it in the perspective. Even so, in a second I will come and maybe contradict myself. Now, the government, with the leading of the Prime Minister, they changed the awareness, they changed the amount of money and other things that are allocated to this issue. Because of it, a total new industry of doctrine and other things came up from these initiatives, as just Igal presented. New directorates, new bodies in the IDF and other places in the Prime Minister office, and special ones. But I want to make sure that everyone understand cyber security, it's what we call a disruptive technology. It's a technology that usually you don't pay attention to. It's like companies like Kodak didn't understand that there is no film anymore. It's going to be a digital memory or other things. And if you are not there, you won't exist. There are some risks in cyber that people don't pay attention. I want to put some of them on the table. I know that not everyone agree with me. 7 years ago, when the cybersecurity directorate was not established, then I was sent to a conference representing Israel in London, and they were talking about regulation. I think that Israel and it belong together, that the more technological you are, the more vulnerable you are. Now, regulation, it's very, very, very dangerous. Everyone is working on regulation. I want to make sure that people understand that if you are a good country, if you are obeying the law, sometimes regulations is against you. Because if you will have regulations, United States, United Kingdom, South Korea, Israel, we will obey the laws, and then the regulations will go after you. And I'm saying it because when you come to conferences, even in the UN, and again, I know it's changing, you see who is pushing towards regulations. Usually are those countries that want international regulation so they can disobey it and all the others will obey it. I want to finish this part in few questions, and I'm not going to answer it maybe later. There are questions, what is, and again, it's between civilian and military or defense. What is deterrence in cyber? What is a legitimate target in cyber? And what is something that you can retaliate on cyber attack? And I assume that every one of you, if everyone was burgling to or coming to your home every day, you are not going to accept it. How come that we are accepting, even in at the government state and of course in the private level, that everyone is going into our private issues, our private assets every day, and who is going to do the best to protect us against those attacks.
Let's hear you, Juan.
Okay. My name is Juan from Korea, South Korea, of course. I'm working for Korean Internet and Security Agency, which is the primary information security organization in Korea. It was established in 1996, and that's when I started to work. So it's been about 23 years working in the cybersecurity area. The first question was, what is the government's obligation to the citizens? Our mission in the cybersecurity is to provide secure and safe internet environments to the people. And the key word is the safety. So when government created KISA, our mission is to protect civilian sectors. The government public sector is under the umbrella of the National Intelligence Service, and private sector falls under the KISA responsibility. So there's a Korean government's obligations in civilian sectors right there. There are three different reasons why we are obligated to the citizens. One, we have constant threats like you have from the North, North Korea. And second is that our economy depends on the ICT growth. More than 20% of our GDP growth depends on the ITC. So there is a great reason for us to protect ICT infrastructures. Third is traditional industries are converging with the IT technologies. For example, automobiles, it's connected to the internet in the future, and the road and the infrastructure must be provided by the government. If that communication, V2 infrastructure communication is disrupted, then the people riding in the vehicle will be endangered, which means it's the government's role to provide those protections for the infrastructures. Another reason, we have seen security in medical devices. I visited Checkpoint 2 days ago, and it's stated that 87% of the medical institutes will be using IoT devices, medical IoT devices by 2019. And there will, if there is any incidences involved with medical devices, it also threatens life of the citizens. So that's why it's the governments have to step in to the cybersecurity area.
Thank you. One of the questions that we are dealing with is compulsory insurance for cyber attack. How do you respond to this idea? Nagel, let's start with you.
You ask a very, very important and not so simple question. Now, I just gave a presentation as a keynote speaker in an insurance company conference in Israel, and they asked me about the cybersecurity threats and what we can do against it. Now, this is a thing that is changing daily and rapidly, but still, when you go to an insurance company, and again, it's not a government doing what we call an internal insurance, the insurance companies, I'm urging everyone here to try to buy an insurance policy for, I don't know, $200 million damage. And cyber attack can be very simple, sometimes $200 million damage. The problem is that the knowledge is not there, and no insurance company will sell you insurance policies for more than a few tens of millions of dollars, and it's almost nothing. So there is a question. Does the government should take this responsibility and insure against cyber security damages and possible disasters? I'm not sure. Insurance company knows sometimes how to do money from those kind of things. The technical experts are for sure making the money now because they are giving them advices, never mind what they're going to do with those advices. I think that insuring cyber security damages will become a branch of the insurance companies, a branch of the technological parts, and I think that we are now in a stage that the questions are much bigger than the answers, but when time will evolve, we'll understand and we can do an actuary calculations of what is the meaning of cyber attacks and their possible damages. Even so, I think we'll always have to make sure that we are taking a risk, because I don't think we can evaluate exactly the damages of cyber attacks.
So I would agree with that, but I would say that when you're looking at cyber insurance, always go in with your eyes open, understanding that it's only going to your point, cover a few areas that, you know, maybe it's the notification of the impacted parties, maybe it's the recovery of some of the hardware that's been damaged as part of the incident. But definitely understand that it may not necessarily cover the entire cost, again, to your point. But one of the things that we do within our state is, as part of our vendor risk management process, we are requiring that vendors, if they are not able to meet a certain level of security, you know, to meet some of the framework requirements that we have, that they have cyber insurance to cover some costs. Because what we don't want to do is to go into business with a startup company, if you will, that may not be necessarily established, that after a cyber incident goes belly up and we run into some issues. So we want to make sure that there's some viability to that company before we engage with them, especially if they're holding our sensitive information.
Just wanted to say, everybody has life insurances. Everybody has car insurances, fire insurances. Why not cybersecurity insurances? The thing is, it's the initial stage at the moment, and we need to build ourselves on top of that. Thing is, when I talk to the insurance companies, they do not have the data to analyze it, to come up with insurance prices. And who has those data? It's the governments. Government receives all the reports on the cyber incidences. Police has all that information. Maybe if we could provide those informations to the insurance companies to share it, to analyze it, and then they can come up with some form of insurance programs so that people can insure. It's like when you have a car accidents, you get insurance fees, but it does not cover everything. It covers some portion of it. It's for the businesses, it's insurances so that you do not go out of businesses, but just to make sure that you will stay in business. And I guess it's the government's role to provide those informations that insurance companies need. And that's the stage that Korean government is working on at the moment.
But one remark, what I meant when I said that insurance companies don't want to sell insurance for cyber, it's because when you have a car insurance, you know that a new car costs $25,000. If there is body damages, sometimes there is an umbrella above, but say, okay, $1 million per body damages, or even life insurances. When you have a cyber security attack damages, Eagle showed here to protect passenger's plane. You know, if, I hope it won't happen, but if a big jumbo with 400 people will be taken down because of a cyber attack, it's billions of dollars in damages or indirect damages. So who can decide what will be the premium for the insurance and who is going to pay for it? But I agree in general that someone has to do. The problem is not the data about the attacks. The problem is the data about the possible damages.
There is always, when we are talking about cybersecurity, there is always issues regarding privacy, freedom of speech, etc. How do you react to this regarding the government role in it?
Well, obviously, we take that very seriously. And you'll see that within the 50 states that we have, there are various elements of privacy acts that they have implemented. Within the state of North Carolina, we had a bill recently that had the most stringent requirements for reporting of cyber incidents within the state. So it is something that we find that if we do not, and to your point you mentioned before about regulations, if we do not have some legislation around there requiring companies and organizations to report these types of information within a specific timeline, that we're failing our citizens. So we definitely take that as a serious act that we need to reemphasize and to legislate.
2 points. First of all, when I said before that if someone will burglar your home, you won't live with it, you ask yourself, if you want someone to protect you, are you willing to give him the permission to officially and under the law or following the law to go into your computer? I'm not sure that the private citizen would like it. But when I'm talking about regulations and the dangerous for regulations, I'm talking about regulations what you are not supposed to do. I am very much for regulation for the government to allow the government to control and to protect you, and by this allowing them sometimes invading your privacy after 9/11. Now in the defense area, there's no doubts. The defense establishments are doing it every day, and they have the right laws to do it. For this, I'm not talking about the dangerous. There are dangerous regulations, but you know our law enforcement agencies are always, by definition, they are invading our privacy. The police, the ISD, the IDF, everyone is invading our privacy. Even when we go to compulsory service, they are invading our privacy. Instead of going to be a student, we are going to compulsory service. I'm talking about regulations on what you are not allowed to do. Then things are very, very, very tough. But I think that like after terror attacks, people understand that sometimes you have to give up your privacy in order to protect yourself. The same here in the cyber area, I think that the government should, under very, very strict laws, sometimes invading the privacy of the citizens.
Thank you.
Well, not just privacy, so I wanted to talk about it in different aspects. We do regulate a lot of things in Korea. For example, companies that does have expenditures more than $1 million, they need to go through ISMS's, Information Security Management Systems. Or if a company wanted to sell their products to governments or public sectors, they have to go through security evaluations against common criteria. And those regulations, for those people, regulated, looks at it as a regulations. But for the information security industries, it's an opportunity promoting cyber securities and thus creating markets, bigger markets. So that's a different way of looking at it. Products, we have evaluations. Services, cloud services, like United States, they have FedRAMP. We have another evaluation programs. Also for the organizations, we have ISMS certifications similar as ISO 27001. It's just that there are a lot of regulations out there, and Korean government's now trying to deregulate the regulations. EU is coming up with GDPRs and security framework, I guess, for the certification of the IoT devices. The thing is, all these countries, we need to talk to each other so that results can be recognized in other markets, other national economies, and those things that we need to discuss it in the future.
Thank you. I would like to move to the second role of the government. It's capacity building. As Igal presented, the Israeli Nationalized Cyber Directorate aims to ensure Israel as a leader in the cyber area. We invest heavily in the industry, R&D, and human capital. What do you think about the role of the government in this area, in the ecosystem area?
So again, my vision is more scoped to the state, but I will say within North Carolina, we have a great support from our governor as it pertains to anything dealing with cyber. We have a lot of, our legislators as well are very supportive of cybersecurity and the ability for us to create pipelines within North Carolina for the future of cyber. We're looking at a couple of our schools. We have 9 NSA Centers of Excellence. I'm not sure if you're familiar with that term. We have 9 of them within the state of North Carolina. We're looking to leverage those in order to further build more cyber professionals, cyber warriors, whatever you want to call them. We're looking at leveraging, and we have programs, apprenticeship programs, to develop using our veterans to develop their capability to support us within the state. But I would say that one of the points that we're not really tapping into, one of our key resources that we're not looking at, are the women in IT. I was looking at statistics recently, and I saw where, depending on which document that you read, that there's 20 to 25% of women in IT. I submit that is an untapped resource, especially when it comes to cyber, that we need to leverage more heavily.
This question is a very simple one. It's much easier than the previous ones, because I think there is no doubt sometimes, and again, I'm coming from in Israel called Mafat, Directorate of Defense and Research. It's not doubt that if it's basic science, infrastructure, academy, education, this is a government role. The government should put the money. Now, this is the citizens' money, and the foundation of the cybersecurity directorates, as was just mentioned, it's exactly part of it. So I think that this is really one of the biggest role of the government. The Israeli government, I was there, I know, they know it's part of their role. I think that the academy, now I'm talking about the professor at Technion, I know that we are establishing those kind of things. We are getting some government money, not enough. We are now going to establish even maybe a cyber first degree direction for the IDF and for the civilians. Igal, if you are here, please excuse me. I think if I have a criticism, and I think it's something that should change, is that this role of education, the director doing very good, and it's you have to make sure it won't stay only as an advisor and as a regulator and as education and research initiator. Sometimes we need also in the government level someone that is not only advising but doing building an infrastructure for this. I think you won't have any objections, and everyone understands this is a government role.
Can I add that I think that what we need to do more from a government perspective is to build cyber within the curriculum from the K-12, which is our kindergarten, through high school students. We tend to focus on the college students. Right now we're leveraging heavily our community colleges because we understand that we can't wait 4 years, right, for someone to go through the whole process to become a cyber professional for us to hire them. So now we're looking at, you know, the 2-year colleges, but even that is short-sighted. We definitely, from a government perspective, need to build the curriculum from the ground up, and then you will have, you know, and to my earlier point as far as females, we'll have more interested females in the sciences and the STEM schools, and we'll have that pipeline already established.
I agree.
Current Korean government's main focus is to create job opportunities. And when we look at cybersecurity area, it's totally different way. One of the statistics stated that there are shortages, 10,000 security professional shortages by year 2020. There is a job openings out there, it's just that we do not have the people with the right skills and knowledges to fill that spaces. And by creating those training programs is the government job. It's just that there are training programs provided in the private sectors that we do not want to conflict with each other. And one of the way that we are trying to do is, remember 5 years ago, that's the first time I heard about OT, IT versus OT. Should we educate IT security people to work for the OT security, or should we provide security programs for the OT people? Now, these days, convergences, automobile people, should we put IT security people in the automotive area, or should we train automobile professionals? That's the questions that we get. And starting from next year, what we are trying to do is provide a cybersecurity curriculum to different majors, automobile majors, electricity majors, so people with the right background will receive security educations and go to the job in that field.
I just wanted to answer your question. You wanted to say, should you have OT people or cybersecurity folks within those different areas? I would say yes. And I think that that is one of the, I won't say the silver bullet right now, but it is a solution to address some of the problems that we're having right now. And we are looking at that. How can we make sure that we educate everyone on cyber and not necessarily just focus it on a small cadre of individuals and professionals that are going to be doing it? Because at the end of the day, we're not going to meet the demand of the 2020, the deficit that we are experiencing right now.
I just want to add one thing that, again, as with the fewest hair on my head, and if it was there, it was white, is that, you know, it's a matter of semantics. You know, in 1998, when we decided there is a big threat, we called it information warfare. We didn't call it cyber. And in 40 years ago, when I went to the university, we just started the computer science. So it's called cyber, and now we are starting to, and I more than agree that we have to start it from beginning. Sometimes the word cyber, from one end, it's very, very, very sexy and very, very tempting, sometimes very frightening. So sometimes it's not really cyber. It's like we teach 40, 50 years ago how to speak Hebrew or English or Arabic, or how to learn other things. This is a language. And if we understand that it's not only, it's very, very wide, we need a lot of interchangeability, interoperability, people that are moving from place to place. We don't have to ask the question, are you an automobile expert or a cyber expert, or maybe even sometimes a medical. Even the medical doctors today have to understand what is cyber. Otherwise, someone can take over their surgery in the middle. So it's all over, but it's a matter of semantic and good declarations of what we are doing.
I must tell that in Israel we start work with talent youth people on 11th grade, but I think that all the idea you raised regarding the curriculum and so on, it's a subject that we can collaborate and think together. I think it's a good opportunity for all of us. I would like to finalize by asking you to say in very, very brief, one sentence for the end.
What I would say is the government needs to take a look at regulation, do not over-regulate, but find that happy balance.
I want to say, if you say one or two sentences, I'll come back to what I started, is that cyber is very, very important. It's a transformation. I'm not sure it's a revolution. Some of it is an evolution. Even some people want to make from it a revolution. It can be very dangerous if you make from it a revolution. It's something that you have to understand. It's evolving. It's influencing all of our life. But I'm not going to compare it to, I don't know, to the invention of engines or even to the inventions of the wheel. It's not more of the same, but it's becoming so wide. This is why, because of the influence of everything that we are doing a conference on cybersecurity, but we have to take it in the right perspective, especially from the government's point of view.
Thank you.
I'll say international cooperations by sharing information and best practices. There is no boundaries that separates nations or public or private domains. I hope everybody in here is in the cybersecurity. We are in the same boat trying to solve the same questions. I hope we solve it together. Thank you.
To summarize, it is quite clear that the new digital era is changing the way governments need to protect its citizens. The ecosystem in Israel is developing multiple solutions to help businesses and government to protect themselves from the new threats. You can see them outside in the exhibition. I want to thank you, everyone, for participants in the panel. Thank you for your time, and have a good day. Thank you.
Thank you.